In the Jungles episode of the BBC's Planet Earth 2, there's a stunning scene of hummingbirds in Ecuador flying in slow motion. And when it aired in the UK, some viewers wondered if the BBC actually created the footage with computer graphics. And you can't blame them. With our own eyes, we'll never see hummingbirds looking like this, just like we'll never see plants growing like this. That's because the camera is warping time. Slow motion shots are made by increasing the camera's frame rate. To slow down action without losing quality, you have to capture more frames. Like the hummingbirds, many of the shots in Planet Earth 2 are at least somewhat slower than real time, or what producers call off-speed. Shooting at 60 or 100 frames per second with playback at 25 frames per second, that tends to heighten the drama and smooth out camera movements in the footage. But slow motion can do more than that. It can also give us a chance to look at processes that our naked eyes could never catch. That's why ultra-high-speed cameras were invented in the first place, cameras that can shoot thousands, even tens of thousands of frames per second. They gave scientists and engineers a way to study all sorts of physical and mechanical processes that happen over milliseconds. And when trained on animals, high-speed cameras can teach us about anatomy and behavior, like the function of these drumstick-shaped organs on flies.
By beating very fast, and here they're slowed down 120 times, they give the fly stability in the air.
The BBC's Natural History Unit filmed this crane fly around 40 years ago. We're used to seeing this kind of thing now, but it was much more of a challenge in the days of film.
You almost always had to do it in a kind of almost a studio setting. And you'd kind of sit there with this button, and you wait, and you hope that something's happened. You press the button, and the camera goes speed up. You then get about 2 seconds of shot, and then you'd hear the film going through the camera as it spun out. You then get it off to be developed, and find that you know in those the 2 seconds that you had, the animal had leapt out of frame or done something, and so throw it away, start again.
The switch from film to digital cameras changed everything. For one thing, they could review the footage on monitors to see if they got their shot. But also, digital high-speed cameras came with a continuous recording feature. Instead of pressing a button to start recording and then pressing it again to stop, they could press the button as soon as they saw some action, and the camera would save the seconds that happened before the button was pressed. That's how the cameraman captured this great white shark coming out of the water, not just in the air, for this sequence in the 2006 Planet Earth series. Unpredictable action was still a challenge. This took them a couple of weeks on a boat to get. But with digital cameras, the BBC brought high-speed photography out of the studio and into the wild, where they could capture things like a chameleon hunting in Madagascar.
You know, they're notorious for these incredible, you know, these tongues that fly out and catch things, and they're really hard, I mean, really hard to film. When we filmed this, you saw that how the tongue kind of unfolds as it goes out, and that everybody thinks they're sticky. They're not. At the end of the tongue is a kind of a muscular blob at the end. It's almost like a hand inside a glove. And this sort of end goes like this and almost grabs the head of this creature and then drags it back, which is sort of ghoulishly ghastly, but also amazing.
Digital cameras also transform the process of making time-lapse sequences for when real life isn't too fast, but too slow. The time-lapse process is basically the opposite of slow motion. Instead of capturing more frames, you take fewer over a longer period of time. Time-lapses can help show animal behaviors that take hours to unfold, like these sand bubbler crabs that make balls out of sand as they look for food during low tide. But the BBC's time-lapse work really got started when they decided in the 1990s to make a series entirely about plants. Time-lapse would be the key tool for bringing the drama of plant growth into our time scale. But no technology existed at the time to automate time-lapse photography. So they invented their own.
And so we developed little computer boxes about this size, which would drive the time-lapse cameras, would drive the flash guns, which would use to make sure that the light was the same, whether there was a cloud out or the sun was out, sun was in, and so on. And we built these little programmable computers, and we took them all around the world, long before, you know, had laptops like you've got, you know, sitting on your lap there.
Some shots could take place out in the wild, but others required more controlled conditions and elaborate sets. These water lily leaves were grown from seeds in huge vats. The water levels, temperature, and lighting all had to be controlled for consistency from shot to shot.
Then, of course, we had to get lots of different shots, close-ups, wide-ups. We wanted to get shots in the tank, looking up, seeing the... And so, I mean, it took months. I mean, just a huge, huge effort. And hopefully, when you look at it, it'll feel seamless.
That series also introduced the technique of tracking time-lapse, where the camera moves too. Now, digital cameras come with the ability to program a time-lapse sequence, and motorized sliders can automate tracking time-lapses. So the BBC keeps pushing the technique further. In 2009's Life, they took it underwater in the frigid Antarctic Ocean to show ribbonworms and sea stars feeding on a dead seal. And in the city's episode of Planet Earth 2, they showcased a new type of time-lapse called Hyperlapse. Now, instead of just moving the camera slightly on a slider, the camera is moving through whole cities, taking thousands of huge images that get stitched together in precise ways on a computer.
So it gives you a kind of a journey in time-lapse.
It might not look like the style of traditional wildlife films, but in fact, the tradition at the BBC has always been to seize new technology and techniques to capture the world in brand new ways.
That's one of the things that's so wonderful about television, is when you can take an audience and show them something that no human eye could ever see, and that only the camera can see.
Thank you for watching. You can find Planet Earth 2 on BBC America. It will be airing Saturdays through March 25th. You can also find tons of clips from their archive on BBC Earth's mobile app. It's called Story of Life, and it's actually where I found a lot of the clips that I used in this video. And it's free, so check it out.